With the rising frequency of 3D anime projects, creating anime-style shaders in Blender is more popular than ever, especially with awesome projects from people such as Dilongu who use Blender in their 3D anime animations. Today, I'm going to show you a line art and shader technique I use to create these anime effects. The first thing you'll notice is I'm in my shader mode here, and there isn't a bunch of noise, and that's because we're not using cycles. It's important to understand that these anime shaders are done in Eevee, which is Blender's real-time engine, so make sure you're in Eevee. To do this, you can left-click this button here, which looks like the back of a camera called Render Properties, and make sure you're in Eevee. You'll also notice I have some lighting in my scene as well. I've just added a basic sun lamp. I'm just going to delete it so we can do it again from scratch. So I'll left click the sun lamp here, and I'm just going to press X to delete it, and I'll press Shift A, and under light, I'm going to add sunlight. Then in the settings here, I'll just leave it at strength of 1, and I'm going to make sure the color is completely white, like this. Alright, now you can see I've already got a bunch of shaders on my character here, so I'm going to show you from scratch how I actually create the cell shading effect. So I'll press Shift A, and then under mesh, I'm going to choose cube. Then I'm going to press G and X to pull out, and G and Z to pull up. You can do this on your character if you like, but I'm just going to do it on a sphere just to demonstrate. First, I'll then press Control 3, and that's going to add a subdivision modifier of 3, which will turn our cube into a kind of sphere. I can then come up to my blue spanner here, the modifier properties, left-click this drop-down, and choose Apply. And now our subdivision surface modifier is the actual editable geometry of this object. And I'm going to right-click and choose Shade Smooth, and I'm going to press Tab to go into Edit Mode. Then I can press A to select everything, and all I'm doing here is I'm going to make it more spherical because it is a little bit cubish still. So under this mesh tab at the top here, you can come to transform, and where it says to sphere, this is pretty much a command that's going to turn any object into a more sphere shape. And if I type in the number 1, that will create the full effect of this to sphere command, as you can see in the top left hand corner. Then I can press enter, and now our change has been made. If that didn't work correctly, you can see that this menu down here will appear, and you can adjust what you've done here. Do keep in mind though, this will disappear once you click away. So press tab to come back into object mode, and now we've got a sphere so we can add some cell shading to. I'm going to first open up my shader menus. So first we've got the material properties, which is this red and black checkered ball here, and I'm also going to change the shader editor, which is a much more complex version of the material properties as it allows you to visualize what's happening using nodes. So I'll change my timeline here to the shader editor, and once you're ready you can just press this plus new. You'll notice how it appears in here as well, as these two menus are linked. I'm going to give this a name like cell shading. I'm first going to left click my principal BSDF and press X to delete it, as we don't need it. Then I'll press Shift A, and under shader we're just going to choose diffuse BSDF. This shader is just like the principal BSDF, but just the color and the roughness, and it's a nice simple shader for our purposes. Then we can press Shift A, and we're going to go for a converter node called shader to RGB. What this does is it will take the shading information. I'm just going to plug this diffuse BSDF into the surface first. You can see this is what the shader is doing. It's reacting to the light, our sun lamp, and using that on top of the material color and roughness, it's then determining what the shader will look like. So you can think of these green nodes here as a box which takes in the information from the scene to figure out how our object is going to look. What this shader to RGB does though, is it will take the shader information and it's going to turn it into color. So you notice after plugging that in, nothing changes. But the difference is color can be edited in more ways than shaders. So I can press Shift A for example, and under converter, I can choose a color ramp. And you can see that I can now use this node here in order to edit color of our shader. Notice how if I left click one of these notches and drag, you can see I can edit things here. And this is the basis of how this anime shader works. But you notice right now that it's still looking very smooth, and we need to have those nice harsh lines that you see in cell shade, like on my model here. So I'm going to change from linear here to constant. And now if I drag this white notch here closer to the black one, you can see we've got a cell shading effect of these two colors. Of course though, this black is a little bit too dark, so I'm going to left click this notch, and I'm maybe going to give it a dark gray color for now. And now you can see we've got a cell shading effect. And you can of course place these colors with any colors you like, which I'll show you how to do when we apply this to our character. There is one small problem though with this method, and that's that if I was to left click my sun lamp for example, and I was to change the color of the sun lamp, you can see how this shader line is changing, and it means that as you change the light you can get some strange changes sometimes with our cell shader. This was something I found out from a creator called Comfy Mugs, and he actually provided the solution to this problem. So if you're looking for a more complex shader, I highly recommend checking out his video to enhance your cell shading workflow. For now though, we're going to go into adding some line art to our sphere here. So I'll left click my sphere to start, and then I'm going to left click this spanner here, and this is going to allow us to add another modifier. So I'll press add modifier, then under generate, or you can just search for it, we're going to add the solidify modifier. Line art can be done with grease pencil as well, but using it with the solidify modifier is my preferred method. However, a solidify modifier is not the only thing we're going to need to add. We actually need a material to act as our line art. So I'm going to left click my material properties, and up at the top here you can see we have plus and the minus button. This allows us to add additional materials to our object. So I'm going to press the plus button, and now you'll see a plain data slot, as you call it, has appeared. And then I can just press plus new, and I'm going to call this line art. In my nodes here, I'm going to left click and press X to delete my principal BSDF. Press shift A, and then under shader, I'm just going to add emission. You can, of course, just use the emission from principal BSDF, but I like to keep things nice and simple. So I'm going to plug my emission into the surface, and I'll change my color to something really dark, like this. If you're wondering what this looks like, you don't have to follow along with this, but I'm going to left-click my cell shading slot and change it to the line art. And now you can see this is the kind of material we've made. Press Ctrl-Z to undo that. Next up, we need to get our emission shader to appear as an outline on our sphere. So to do that, I'll come back to my modifier properties, and in our solidify modifier, I'm first going to open up the normals and the materials, and I'm going to change my material offset from 0, which is our first material, to 1. And you can see now that our black materials appear. This 0 and 1 represents the data slots. So you can think of it this way. If I come back to my material properties here, cell shading is the 0 slot and line art is the 1 slot. So rather than 1 and 2, it's more like 0 and 1. So it starts from 0. Come back to my modifier properties here, and you can see now that this material offset is 1, so the second material has been chosen. I'll come back to my material properties again, and we do need to check one more setting, and that's the back face color. Then we can turn on the flip and the high quality. And finally, we can turn on the fill on rim. And now if I turn up my thickness, you can see we can start to get some outlines here. If you make it too high, it will cause some issues. Thankfully though, you'll need a little bit of subtlety to get this line art effect. I went for a value of 0.01, but you may need to adjust it for your model, as I used a completely different value for my model here. The reason we turn on backface culling is if I come back to my material properties and turn it off, you can see it just makes the whole thing black. So we need to turn it on in order to see our line art. All right, now we understand the basics of how these cell shaders work, let's take a look at our character here. So to start off, I'm going to left click my sun lamp, and I'm going to press R and X just to rotate it, and I'm going to rotate it so we can actually see some of our character here. There we go. You can see that our sphere has reacted to this light as well. To start off, I'm going to show off some of these shaders here. So I'll left click my character, and you can see I've got a toon skin shader. So this shader setup is exactly the same as the one we created. If I want to recreate it, I'll left click my sphere here, and if I click my cell shading material, I'm going to change it to this kind of nicer brown color. It can take a little bit of tweaking to get the kind of color you're looking for. You can tweak the shadow as well, make that a bit darker, until we get something like that. Another thing you can sometimes add is highlights. So if I left click my sphere, I'm going to press the plus button. You can see that's added another notch here. And if I drag this notch out, you can see this is going to add another color. So I can maybe change this to something a little brighter like that. And now we've got some highlights. I did have highlights on my character here as well, but it sometimes creates some weird effects, so I just removed it. What I did keep highlights on though, however, was the hair. If I bring these in here by just dragging the slider, you can see I've got some nice highlights on my hair as well. This is a little out of the scope of the complexity of this tutorial, but you can see I've got some more complex shaders here as well. So if I left click my t-shirt here, you can see I've used the image texture in order to create some complex designs. Then I've got this jeans effect as well, which I made myself using a magic texture and a few other nodes. So you can see there's a lot of complexity you can get using this cell shader system. If you guys do want to see some tutorials on how I done this denim effect, for example, or this t-shirt, please feel free to let me know, and I'll make a second follow-up tutorial on how to do that. You can also see here the eyes. I've got quite unique anime eyes here. These are like 3D anime eyes, because I use this model for a more semi-realistic version of my character here, Akira, who's the channel's mascot. So typically you'll see a kind of textured eye used in this style. So if you want to learn how to do that as well, feel free to let me know, and I'll make a tutorial on how to do that kind of eye as well. But these eyes here are pretty much just using the same method that we've learned today. So nothing more complex than what you've learned so far. Another thing to note as well is if I left click my model here and I come to my modifier properties here and scroll down, you can see this is using this solidify modifier as well, and it's using a different value, as you may need to tweak the value for different models. The final thing I want to show you is how we can copy materials and modifiers to other objects to speed up our workflow. So I'm going to press shift A, and this time I'm going to choose cube. I'll press G and Z to pull that up, G and X to pull this across. I'm going to first add the cell shading shader, so I'll press the plus to add a new slot here, and then in this drop down I'll choose cell shading. I'll press the plus again, and I'm going to choose my line art, or just search for it, and now we've got that set up. I can just come to my blue spanner here, and rather than adding a new modifier, I can actually left click my cube, then shift left click my sphere here, and on the solidify modifier you can left click this drop down and choose copy to select it. Now you can see we've got our line art around our cube. If you want to make it a bit bigger, maybe let's turn it to 0.3. There we go. We've got a nice strong line art there now. And so you can copy modifiers that way. Another thing you might want to do is if I come to my material properties here, some of you may not know about this, but if you left left-click this button here, you can duplicate this material, which means this is now its own independent thing, so I can maybe call this gray or something like that, and then I could tweak these colors like that. Now you can see we've got a gray cell shader, and our other cell shader remains untouched. Last thing I want to talk about is improving the quality of the shadows in Eevee, as sometimes you can get some issues. So I'm going to come up to my render properties. First of all, make sure you've got a nice sample count here. I've gone with 50. These bloom and screen space reflections aren't really too relevant to shadows. You've also got your shadows settings here, so this might be closed for you, but I've just opened it up. I'm going to change my cube size to 4096 and this to 4096 as well, and that is the highest quality. Do keep in mind this will mean a slower render, but not by a large margin as it is Eevee. You can also turn on your high bit depth, and sometimes having soft shadows on can help as well. I'm going to show you what it looks like if I turn off some of these settings. So for example, if I maybe turn this down to 512, you can see this is looking pretty horrible. So make sure to keep this on a nice high number if you can. Enabling high bit depth can also help as well. Now that we've concluded our anime shaders work, if you want to learn more about shaders in general, I highly recommend checking out this free course I made on everything you need to know about textures and materials in Blender for beginners. But apart from that, thank you very much for watching, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video. Take care.